O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. We were singing a moment ago, "Created me a clean heart, O God," as we prepared to eat the bread and drink the cup. And that made me think of that psalm from which those words are taken, Psalm 51, where David, having sinned grievously, was pouring out his soul before God and asking for forgiveness. He asked God, "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your loving kindness. According to the multitude of your tender mercies, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me. Cleanse me from my sin." And then we ate the bread. We remembered his body and how he suffered in his body for us. We drink the cup as we just did, and we remember the blood that he shed. That's what cleanses us. That's why we can have a clean heart. That's why we can stand before God, a holy God. We can be in his presence and be in fellowship with him because we can be cleansed and washed from our iniquity by the blood of Christ. What a joy that is. And it's a joy to sing how our Lord lives. It's because he lives that we're here today. It's because he was raised from the dead that we can be justified and have hope of eternal life. Now, if you're visiting, we're glad you're here. We have some visitors with us this morning. It's wonderful to have you in our midst. And we want you to know God and know that justification that we have in Christ, the cleansing that will make you whole, and by which then you can draw near to God. So let us know if we can help you with that. This morning I want to talk about a particular vice. It's a sin we all have to struggle with, a vice of which no one is free. It's something we all loathe when we see it in others, yet hardly anyone sees it in himself. We despise it when other people manifest it, yet it's so hard for us to think that we're guilty of it ourselves. It's a vice which more than anything else makes one despised in the sight of others. And really, here's an irony, that the more we have of this vice ourselves, the more we dislike it and abhor it when we see it in others. It's a vice which, in the biblical worldview, from the Christian perspective, is the worst of all sins, because it is the vice that is behind all other sins. It is the one that leads to all other sins. One theologian called it the complete anti-God state of mind. And because it is the anti-God state of mind, it's the chief cause of misery in the world, every family and every nation, in all times and places, suffers most because of this vice. What is it? I'm talking about the sin of pride with you this morning. Now, I'm really proud of this next slide, so I want you to watch this. See, wait for it. I know, you're not impressed, but, you know, it takes a while to play around with PowerPoint and get it to do stuff like that. So I want to call this lesson, we're going to have a couple of lessons here in dealing with this. We're going to look at pride for several lessons, actually. So you might think of this here at the League City Church of Christ as Pride Month, where we're going to be looking at the problem of pride. The problem of pride. That's what you can write down if you're taking notes. You can put that at the top of the page. I want you to write that out in your notes or see it in your mind. Make note of it as you see it before you hear. Now, here's one more. We can ooh and ah. Yes, marvel at the inverse of the colors there. I know. I'm easily impressed by these kind of things. But all right, so first of all, what the Bible says about pride. Now, we all know that it's a sin. And it's not hard to find passages in God's word condemning it. We don't have to look far in Scripture. From beginning to end, we see this is man's chief problem. And we see it condemned in the strongest of terms. When you go to the wisdom literature of Israel, for example, you go to the book of Proverbs especially, again and again, we're warned about arrogance. It's the same word that translated in other Bibles, pride. Like Proverbs 16:5, everyone who is arrogant in heart, your Bible might say proud in heart, is an abomination to the Lord. Be assured, he will not go unpunished. Now, here is perhaps the first passage people think of if they know their Bibles when the subject of pride comes up. And it might read in your Bible, I think this is how people know it. It's more familiar as pride goes before destruction. Well, here in the ESV, it's before destruction, a man's heart is haughty. Again, the same word, arrogance, haughtiness, conceit. And notice how it's contrasted with humility. See, that's the opposite. That's the virtue that is opposite the vice of pride, but humility comes before honor. Now, in Proverbs 16, we're told famously of seven things God hates. And the very first one, haughty, proud eyes. Your Bible might say a proud look. But that's another way of just simply saying pride. God hates pride. Pride. James tells us, we come to the New Testament, that God gives us the grace that we need, but he opposes. He does not give grace to the proud. He gives grace to the humble. And then he goes on to say, that's verse 6, but in James 4:10, then he says, he concludes after telling us we ought to weep and mourn over our sin. And then he says, humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will exalt you. See, rather than the prideful exaltation of self, rather than exalting yourself, let God exalt you. Well, how will God exalt me? When I'm willing to humble myself. And so again and again we see this. You know, in 1 John 2:15 through 17, John says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. And listen how strong his language is here. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Well, what is love of the world then? He says, for all that is in the world, this is the world as John defines it, the desires of the flesh, the desires of the eyes, and the pride of life. It's not from the Father, but it's from the world. And the world passes away, he says in verse 17, and its lusts. But he who does the will of God abides forever. So we see the strong language with which pride is condemned again and again, and that's because it is so dangerous and destructive to our souls. Let's think about that a little bit further here. And we can see, we can understand the danger of this to our souls if we think a little bit more about what it is. What are we talking about here? Now, what I'm going to give you here, and this is an unusual lesson. I've never done a PowerPoint like this before where I just list so many statements, one after another after another. So I know it's kind of overwhelming you here, but I'm hoping by layering these statements one on another, it's reinforcing these points for you. And I'm not giving so much a technical definition here, but talking about what's involved with it. What's behind it, or what ways in which it is manifested, things that are connected to it, right? And I think you'll understand what I mean. It's when we think too highly of ourselves, and we ought to have a certain kind of self-regard or concern for yourself. Love your neighbor as yourself. But Scripture warns us, as Paul does, for example, in Romans 12, not to think of ourselves more highly than we ought to think. It's that arrogance or vanity, boastfulness, where we want attention from others because we feel that we should be the center of all things. It's that self-centeredness, that self-promotion. It's that pleasurable feeling that we get when we think of how we might be above someone else, that we're better than others. And it doesn't have to be necessarily being better than others universally, but just in whatever peer group we're in, or whatever subset of friends that we have. However small it might be, if you're just a little better or a little more knowledgeable or have a little bit more understanding about this or that, there's a feeling that we get that makes us feel good about ourselves from being in some way, somehow, better than someone in some relation to us. That pleasure that comes from that, and in turn then the anger we feel when we're not acknowledged. We feel that other people should think highly of us or think as highly of us as we do of ourselves, and so we feel resentment or we get upset when we don't get our way. This is all what is involved here with pride. That's why it's so destructive. And you can think of how pride loves power. That's really what it's seeking. Now, when you say power here, that can mean political power. You might think of someone who is a powerful dictator and yet still wants to go conquer other lands because he still wants more. He still wants to exert his will over more and more territory and over more and more people, that lust for power. It's what drives a lot of people to seek public office, to be elevated in that way, and to have the pleasure that comes from imposing your will. But I want you to think of, in more practical terms, not so much political power, but just this idea where we just get our way, where we're able in some situation to insist on our own way. It could be something very small, very subtle. You know, disagreement over how the flowers should be arranged on the table. I want it done my way. Or how the picture should be situated on the cabinet or on the wall. Or it can be something minor and subtle like that, but where we feel that others should give deference to us and that we should be allowed to have our way, and that gives you a certain sense of satisfaction knowing that you're being acknowledged. Now that's why we said what we did at the outset of the lesson. If you take all of that into account and we think for a moment about the implications of it, maybe when I started you think that it was overstating the case to say this is the worst of all vices. But if you really think about what's involved with it, that's why you realize it is the worst of all sins. Because it's the assertion of the self that I think so highly of myself that I should be free to do as I please and I shouldn't have to submit to the will of someone else. That's what really is behind sin, the first sin that came into the world, and every sin ever since, including every sin in my own life. Somehow, some way, at the root of it is this pride. It's what leads to the other sins. We might think, well, isn't lust more dangerous? Isn't envy, covetousness? We might think of other things. Well, isn't murder a far graver iniquity than something like pride? But what is it that makes a person think he can take the life of another person? That he should have the right to take that person's life? I mean, murder here without just cause, not self-defense or the state executing a criminal. Well, again, you can see that somewhere along the way, even if we're not conscious of it, there is this pride that says, I should be able to do this. And that's why I'm going to do it. And that's why we said it's the complete anti-God state of mind. We cannot submit to God when we are insisting that our will be done, right? And so because it's what's behind sin, and sin is what separates us from God, sin is what brings turmoil and hardship and ruin into our lives. Sin is what causes the breakdown of the family, of the home, of the culture, of the society. Sin is what brings misery to the world, and that's why we can say really pride then is the chief cause of misery in the world. You can see the magnitude of it if we really think about it in those terms. Now, let's go a little further and think about how it prevents us from knowing God. Knowing God and the problem of our pride. You know, God is, and this is something we really need to reflect on and acknowledge. But God is not just better than us and not just superior to us, but God is immeasurably superior to us in every conceivable way. But as long as we're proud, if we're elevating ourselves so that we feel better about ourselves looking down on others, if we're always looking down, we're not going to look up to see God. We're not going to look up to acknowledge God. And so as long as we're proud, we cannot truly know God. That's staggering when you think of that. And then the inverse, the more we know God, the more humble we become, and the converse of that. The more we do come to surrender ourselves to God, the more, and it takes humility to do that, but then the more humble we become in turn. And we'll return to that here in a moment, but you might have heard of C.S. Lewis, or you might have heard me quote C.S. Lewis before, the great theologian of the 20th century, an apologist for the Christian faith. But here's a well-known quote from Mere Christianity in his chapter called The Great Sin. I'm taking some of these thoughts from that chapter, and I encourage you to read it. It'll only take you a few minutes to read through that short chapter. But there, when he's talking about the sin of pride, he says, the real test of being in the presence of God is that you either forget about yourself altogether. That's how great and how mighty God is. You either forget about yourself altogether, or you become aware of how small you are, that he says, you see yourself as a small and dirty object. And he goes on to say, better to forget yourself and be lost in God. And I think these are all thoughts that take some time to reflect upon. I'm just putting them before you to help us see how serious an issue this is. Now, think about being religious and the problem of pride, our religion and our pride. Why do we bring this up? Because it's not just something that people outside in the world have to deal with. It's not just something we look outside the church and condemn in others. Because we can believe in God, and we can attend church and be at every service, and we can sing the praises and repeat the prayers, and we can go through all the motions and still be eaten up with pride that's sobering to think of. Well, how can that be so? If I really believe in God, and I'm think of myself as a follower of Christ, and I'm in the midst of my brothers and sisters, you know, how could I still be struggling with pride? Well, where pride comes in is if we're imagining how God approves of us because we are His children, because we are in His church, and we do belong to Him, and so that makes us better than others. Well, in a sense, it makes us better in that we're striving to live better lives, but we can get this sense of smugness or superiority that people find so disdainful, even in religious people, where we think we're superior to others. Or if you become aware of that and you say, you know what, I realize that I've been thinking too highly of myself, or I've been thinking of how God approves of me, and that makes me better than others. And so I'm going to push those thoughts away, and I'm going to be humble. Well, then we can start to be quite satisfied with our humility, right? Thinking highly of ourselves for how humble we are. Which is a paradox, isn't it? And so even when we fight pride, our suppression of pride can itself become a source of pride. The devil can use even that to make us feel self-satisfied. You see the trouble, the temptation there? Lewis addresses that brilliantly in the Screwtape Letters, where the demon instructs his underling in trying to destroy the life of a Christian to get him, first of all, get him to be proud, but if you can't get him to be proud, get him to be proud of not being proud. And the way he goes about it is absolutely masterful. But now, before we close, I want us to clarify, and you might think, well, that's something we should have done at the beginning. Usually you define your terms and you say, I'm not saying this, but I am saying this. But I wanted to hold this till now, misunderstandings about it. We're not saying, let me give you three things here. We're not saying pleasure in being praised is sinful pride, right? Where you think, you know, I did a good job and I'm proud of myself, in the sense that you appreciate being acknowledged. We do desire the approval of other people, and it makes us feel good if other people praise us. Where the trouble comes is if we take that to feel better about ourselves. Well, we're more pleased with ourselves than with the praise. See, I feel good if you compliment me on a sermon or on a class. Think of it yourself when you receive a compliment. That pleases me. It makes me happy that I benefited you somehow. It makes me feel good about myself that you feel good about it. And so it isn't, if we respond, and I'm not saying I respond in the right way all the time. You know, we can get a big head when people compliment us. That's why someone will say, a lot of times people will preface a compliment and say, well, look, don't let this go to your head, or don't get a big head now, but that was one of the best sermons you've ever done, or something like that. We see that the problem is when we get to think more about ourselves, when we're thinking more about ourselves than the fact that we're glad that it pleased you. We're glad that it made you feel good, and that makes me feel good to know that you feel good. So we don't mean taking a pleasure in pleasing other people. But here, even here, though, we have to be careful, because some people might pride themselves in not caring what other people think. You know, they say, well, I'm not getting any compliments. Well, I don't care what other people think. And that's a prideful condescension, where you think that the opinions of others don't matter at all. Now, of course, when other people's opinion of us shouldn't matter is when it contradicts God's opinion. What ought to matter supremely to us is what God thinks of us. And that ought to be what is foremost on our minds and hearts, that we want to please Him. And that's what matters to us, what God thinks of us and not what others think in that sense. But it's not wrong to feel good about being acknowledged. We don't mean when you take pleasure in the accomplishments of others or you admire others, that's not sinful pride. When you say you're proud of your son, a lot of times we use the word that way. That's not what we're talking about when we looked at these passages about pride and when we looked at all the implications of it. I'm proud that my son is serving in the most powerful peacekeeping force on the face of the earth, the United States Army. That makes me proud. I'm proud my daughters married godly men and that they have faithful Christian marriages and are raising their kids to know God. When we say, you know, we're proud of this or we're proud of that, that's not the sinful kind of pride that we're talking about here. Now, it can be if, again, we feel that makes us superior to others, because look at my kids. You know, my kids are better than your kids. Of course, my kids are better than your kids, but if that makes me Well, I'm going to just say my grandkids are definitely better than your grandkids. But you understand that we can have a righteous satisfaction when we see others do well. And so we're proud of them in that sense. And we might say, you know, I'm proud of America. I'm proud to be an American. We don't mean that. We mean it in the sense that Lee Greenwood meant it, and not in a sinful way. But then finally, this is why I wanted to end with this, to lead into our closing thought. But God doesn't forbid pride as though He's offended somehow, that it offends His dignity, as though He is proud. Now, we see in Scripture God is jealous for His name. God is jealous. He won't allow the honor that belongs only to Him to be given to another. He says that to Israel over and over about their idolatry. You should have no other gods before me, because He alone is worthy of our worship. He is Himself worthy of it. But it's not because somehow God is offended or that God is diminished when we don't humble ourselves and submit to Him. It's because God wants us to know Him. And as we said earlier, pride is what keeps us from surrendering our will to His. When we're self-centered, when we're trying to have all the attention focused on us, when we're insisting that I have to have my way, that keeps us from knowing God. But there is no greater blessing than we can have. Nothing we need more than to know God and be in relationship with God. And when we do come to finally see God as He really is and ourselves in relation to Him, it's a great relief that we can let go of all the pretense and the silliness of parading around and feeling like we have to stick our chests out and assert our way and act like we're all that in a bag of chips. That's in the Bible somewhere, I think. But the idea of that we can finally let go of all of that and realize our worth and our value isn't in elevating ourselves, but acknowledging Him who is exalted above all. And that's where we find our true selves. And so it's because God wants to make that possible, He tells us to be humble, so that we can find our true selves and what we were made for in relation to Him. You see, it's interesting that it's a paradox that in a way I have to acknowledge that it's not all about me so that I can acknowledge God. And when I do that, I actually find that God is about me in that sense. That's why Jesus said, if you deny yourself, you'll find yourself. Deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. If you deny yourself, in John 12:25, you'll find your life, you'll save your life unto eternal life. And so we need to think about that properly. That's why we think of James again. When we come back to James, what is it we most need to do? Humble ourselves before the Lord. You see how sinful pride is. You see how silly, how absurd, how outrageous, how perverse to think that we ought to parade around and demand that other people celebrate us and that we insist everyone celebrate us and that everyone look at us and that everyone say, see, it's me, me, me. See how good I am. See how great it is that I'm this way. No, we regard that rightfully as repulsive. To have 30 days where we do nothing but that is all the more disgusting. Humble yourself before the Lord. He will exalt you. Listen, is there something keeping you from turning to God? Maybe you're not a Christian and you feel that whatever's been preventing you from responding to the gospel, from being baptized into Christ, maybe you've rationalized that and you feel like that's a legitimate excuse. But I hope you'll think about, could it just be your pride that it's hard to humble ourselves? It's hard to say, I've been wrong. It's hard to say, I need to change. To swallow our pride, as we say. And to say, I need God. I have offended a holy God, and I need His forgiveness. I need to surrender my will to His. That can be hard, but whatever it is that's keeping you from doing that, from surrendering to Him, there's the pride at the root of that. Cut it off. Brother or sister, if you've not been faithful, if you've not lived right before God, maybe it's some kind of problem with pride that's keeping you from acknowledging that, from saying to your brothers and sisters, I'm sorry, I've sinned. I need your encouragement. I need your prayers. It's hard to admit that we need other people to help us. It's hard to admit that we're not right with God, that we're not who we've pretended to be, or what others might think we are. But swallow that pride, surrender that pride. Let me close with a powerful passage in Micah and the prophets. And it's one of my favorite Old Testament texts where here's the prophet thinking about his relationship to God and what could he possibly bring to God. He says, with what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God Most High? Shall I come before him with sacrifices, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I give the firstborn for my transgressions, the fruit of my body, for the sin of my soul? He has shown you, O man, what is good, and what the Lord requires of you: to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God. Let's humble ourselves in the sight of the Lord, and He will exalt us. Let's stand and sing this song together.